It's a great privilege for me to be here and to speak on my most interesting topic. For years, we have been watching many great debates between science and religion. But now, I wanted to say with the advent of modern science that there is no need for any debate. The modern science pronounced the death of such debates. It should not be science or faith, but science and faith. The riots of science and technology points out that belief in God is not foolish, and belief in God is more rational than belief in a place where there is no God. Where belief in atheism is more foolish compared to belief in God if you see the latest scientific evidence. Before starting my talk, I would say that this is the most interesting topic that I normally address. Let me start with a little story from my life, why I am interested in this topic, and then proceed to address this. One of my early memories, probably when I was about 7, was lying on a cot with my siblings in the open air in my grandpa's house in a village near Tuticorin, looking up at the starry sky with the wild imaginations of a child. We would try to spot the constellations and memorize their names. My father, who was then a college professor, would give us big reference book on the stars, and we enjoyed locating the constellations and showing them to our friends. We were all fascinated by the richness and splendor of skies. I used to often gaze into the night sky, being amazed at this vastness, thinking, why is the night sky dark? Why at all are stars shining? But later, this interest in space also in one way contributed to taking up aerospace engineering as my master's and my PhD subject at IISc Bangalore. Even during my period of depression almost 2 decades back, I would stare at the night sky during those sleepless nights, and I used to get this strange feeling within me that the God who holds all these stars and keep the planets in their orbits will be able to take care of this little life of mine. Then after I met Jesus in a deathbed in pneumonia while I was in ventilator, and heard his voice that he's giving me a new life, I gave my life over to God. I wanted to know whether this God of the Bible is rational and whether the latest scientific evidence points to this God or not. That is why the last 4 to 5 years, I took up research on various fields of science, geology, archaeology, biology, astrophysics, cosmology, and then came out at some astounding understanding. Because at the end of this research, I ended up writing my book, Beyond the Boundaries of Science, and also I'm involved in making a series of episodes on the universe called The Grand Cosmic Story, which forces the viewers to think. This is posted in the YouTube channel. My main aim is to show that science is not against the Christian faith. Because we always talk of debate between science and Christian faith, and people think there is a conflict. But why this notion of conflict came from? This is because of the wrong picture that was painted by some outspoken atheistic scientists that there is a warfare between science and faith. In 1896, Andrew Dixon White published a book called A History of the Warfare of Science with Theology in Christendom. This was later propagated by a few scientists like Richard Dawkins, Stephen Hawking, Peter Atkins, and so on. Peter Atkins, former professor at the University of Oxford, said, "Science and religion cannot be reconciled. Religion has failed, and its failure should be exposed." Christian Hitchens, in his book, said, "God," in his book, which is called God is Great, he said that religion is poison because it asks us to give up our most precious faculty, that is the reason. That it asks us to believe in things without evidence. Even Richard Dawkins, the most famous atheist, said that religious fanatics want people to switch off their minds, ignore the evidence, and blindly follow a holy book based upon private revelation. But for me, it was opposite. When I opened my mind and I started searching for evidence, everything pointed to my God. Even Richard Dawkins says, faith is dangerous. Do not indoctrinate your children. Teach them how to think and weigh up evidence. You know, he also attacks this our religion through a fallacy called God of the Gaps. Have you heard of this term? Earlier days, when lightning strikes, people used to think that it is by God, that God is doing something. But later, when science told the reason behind lightning, that God, which was in that gap, was expelled. So he said that when scientific advancement comes, all the gaps will be filled by modern science and God will be expelled. Many of his books like God Delusion are all bestsellers, and many youths are carried away from that. And many have lost their faith. Kinnaman, he has written a book, Why We Have Lost Our Youths. He says the third main reason, the first reason is hypocrisy of Christians. The third reason is anti-science. So that is why this is not only an important topic, an interesting topic, but the most relevant topic. Is there a conflict between science and faith? I would strongly say that there is a conflict, but not between science and faith, but between two worldviews. Atheism, that says everything we see, that's all is existing. Space, time, and matter, that's all. There is nothing behind it. And theism, that says that there is a God beyond everything, is omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient. So these are the two worldviews that are in conflict. It's not between science and religion, because these two worldviews have different presuppositions about reality, about the ultimate reality. So today I'm going to address the question, when scientific knowledge advanced, whether science is able to take over faith, as Dawkins said, or whether scientific evidence shows faith in God is rational and that there is no need for a debate between them. First, let's find out what history points us to. Let's go back to this period when the modern science started. It started in the Western Europe during the period of Newton, Kepler, Boyle, Galileo, and Copernicus, the period that historians call as scientific revolution. They were typically Christian believers, and science flourished vigorously during that period. Science became the motor that drove the belief in God. They believed in intelligibility. That means the mind I have to do science is given by an intelligent creator. Because if I don't have an intelligent mind, I cannot do even science. That means I cannot even do understand nature. So there is an intelligent being who did everything such a way intelligently that when I look at it, that will reveal to me my creator. That's why Paul says beautifully in Romans 1:20, the unseen qualities of God and the wisdom of God can be known in the works of creation. Newton, sir, you know Isaac Newton, sir. Isaac Newton was one of the famous scientists that we have ever seen. Best scientist, I would say. In his famous book, Principia Mathematica, made design argument based on the fine tuning of the arrangement of the planets in our solar system. He argued that beautifully everything is fine tuned and the orbits are, all the planets are orbiting around the sun in a beautiful way because it's designed by a powerful and an intelligent being. He wrote that this most beautiful system of sun, comets, and planets could only proceed from the counsel of an intelligent and a powerful being. In fact, design is evident in nature. No one can deny the beautiful and intricate design in the nature. Look at the horses. Have you ever seen how fast it can run? Because it has huge lungs, it has huge heart, just like your turbocharger in your car to draw more oxygen. Look at the camel. It's supposed to work in the desert. They have non-sinking feet, 3 eyelids and eyelashes to protect themselves from the sandstorm. Have you ever seen the beautiful coral leaves? The coral animals are designed with a hard exoskeleton, and that's why it makes a coral reef appear like rock. They have special cells called chromatophores that can produce bright coloring. cuttlefish cannot see, but they are able to rapidly change the color of their skin to match their surroundings. Like this, you can go on and go on. Penguins are underwater flyers. They could survive in seawater because they have a special gland called supraorbital gland. Even there is a whale called humpback whale. It has a remarkable ability to sing songs with musical patterns to communicate across thousands of miles across the oceans. So who even Wright brothers developed their first flight, powered flight, seeing the birds. But with all these things, if all these design cannot come without a designer, any human beings will say. But why this idea of warfare came? The first, it came because of a man called Laplace. He was a French physicist. He wrote a book called The Celestial Mechanics that became one of the greatest classics, in which explained the origin of the solar system as a result of purely undirected natural forces without recourse to any intelligence. So he was called before Napoleon to receive commendation for making French science proud. The story goes like this. Napoleon looks at him and asks, "This is such a huge book. It tells about everything, but there is no mention of God." Then Laplace said, "I don't need that hypothesis." So by then, God became a hypothesis. If Laplace attempted to explain the origin of solar system without God, Charles Lyell came along in geology and he attempted to explain the origin of the great geological features like mountains, canyons, everything without God. Then came Charles Darwin. He attempted to explain the origin of new species from simpler pre-existing species to the greatest one. He showed that it's a tree. It starts everything from a small microorganism and it goes like a tree, and finally we end up in human beings. So like this, it started. So many, but what happens? This is a naturalistic scenario. This is the atheistic scenario. This is about in the 19th century. But in the 20th century, something major happened. Revolution happened. We got a lot of scientific advances, and every scientific advance pointed to the fact that all these things are wrong. Charles Lyell was proved wrong. Charles Darwin was proved wrong. Laplace was proved wrong. So today I am going to explain to you all these three things. The first, let me start with universe. Let me come to our planet Earth, and then let me come to our life. So I need some more time. I will try my best to compress it. So I'll make it interesting with a lot of stories. So, you know, we live in an extraordinarily grand universe. And it's why I call it as extraordinary and grand. If I will take you to a journey through some of my videos. We live in a Milky Way galaxy. This is so huge that if I travel with the speed of light, go from one end to the other end, I need 100,000 years. Light travels a trillion miles per second. Trillion miles per second, I need 100,000. With that speed, I can go around our Earth 7.5 times in just a second. So that huge is our galaxy. Now, you know, there are around 2 trillion galaxies scientists have formed. Have you heard of this Hubble Deep Field Experiment? When Hubble telescope was launched with a budget of $1.5 billion, what happened, you know, that it started to give blurry images instead of beautiful. So they were all so much scared. And finally, 7 days, 5 scientists were walking on the space and they corrected the error of the mirror. And now, till now, it sends beautiful array of images. Some years ago, NASA scientists decided they wanted to go still deeper. They picked a little patch of the sky about the size of a pencil. Just think, little patch of the sky about the size of the pencil. Then they pointed the finely honed lens of the Hubble telescope at that little patch. And then they made the Hubble to go around the Earth. And again, they'll make it to point towards for 20 minutes. And then again, it will go. So like that, they did around 400 times, 20 minutes around the Earth, and then again 20 minutes. So like this, they did 400 times. At the end, They collected all the information. They put it together. They found something amazing. In that little patch of space, it was not one star. It was not a cluster of stars. It was 10,000 billion galaxies with trillions of stars in it, and many have even planets surrounding it. So I will show you now two videos that will show you how all these things, you can check it up through my video. So first is Hubble Space Telescope I'm showing, and then
this is the observable universe, holding around 2 trillion galaxies, and its radius is estimated to be an unfathomable 46.5 billion light years. I believe what lies in the world that cannot be observed could be even more massive, of which our known universe is just a tiny slice.
So this is the way you can see the vastness of the universe. It's too huge. It's too huge. And one more amazing thing is this whole universe, this whole set of galaxies are just in expanding. The expansion rate is increasing day by day. This was first discovered by Sir Albert Einstein on November 15, 1915. When he brought out his most famous and elegant equation that rules the universe, the general theory of relativity, that transformed our understanding of space and time. While Sir Isaac Newton spoke of absolute space and absolute time, Einstein said that space and time are relative to each other. But the interesting story is his field equations revealed that the universe is expanding. But Einstein didn't want to believe it, because he believed in a steady state universe, that the universe existed forever. It didn't have a beginning. So what he did, he posited an arbitrary constant. That constant allowed the right strength to prevent the universe from expanding. But his mathematics was better in telling the truth than he wanted to believe. During that time, Edwin Hubble, an American astronomer, peered into the sky using the powerful 100-inch Hooker telescope, and he was surprised at what he saw, that the whole set of galaxies are moving away from one another. He found that the light coming from them is shifted towards the red end of the electromagnetic spectrum, indicating that these objects are moving away from us very, very fast. Let me give you an illustration. If an ambulance comes towards you, you can hear the pitch of the siren increases. But if it moves, the pitch decreases. The same way, if the galaxies are moving towards us, the light will be shifted towards the blue end. If it moves away, it shifts towards the red end. So because it shifted towards the red end, he understood the galaxies are moving at a great speed away from us. During that time, Father Georges Lemaître, a mathematician, was working with Einstein's equation. When he read about Hubble's findings, he understood that both experimental results from Hubble is there and Einstein's equation is there. He concluded there's a definite beginning to the universe, just as his Bible said. In the beginning, God made heaven and earth. Because if you extrapolate back in time, you will end up at a point when time, space, and matter started. But he went and told Einstein the story. But Einstein said, your calculations are right, but your physics is atrocious. He was not ready to believe even then. But once Hubble invited Einstein to his place, and Einstein saw personally through the windows of Hubble's observatory at Mount Wilson, and he was convinced, and he came out and told the media, I now see the necessity of a beginning. And this idea of a one-time beginning was upsetting to many scientists. Arthur Eddington said that the notion of a beginning is repugnant to me. It leaves me cold, because if there is no beginning, we need not think about its cause. we need to now find a reference beyond it, since it has a beginning, a transcendent cause. The cause must be beyond the universe, beyond space and time. So that's why Alan Sandage, who was once a long-time agnostic, said, now you have the evidence that nothing it can explain except a supernatural event. Then scientists, whatever they try now, I can't go in depth because of the time, they are trying a lot of things to find how this started. They have to incorporate all the four forces of nature. And that theory is called the theory of everything. Einstein was after that theory, but he died without finding it. Stephen Hawking was after that theory, but even he died without finding it. And people have postulated multiverse theory and many other theories like oscillating universe to explain it, but nothing could explain the one-time beginning of the universe, except you posit a supernatural God who is beyond the space, time, and matter, just as Bible said. Now, coming to the second part, Earth. First, we saw the universe. From the universe, we clearly can see that there is, the science is pointing to the fact that there is a God. Next, come to the Earth. In 1977, the twin spacecrafts named Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 broke free from the Earth's gravity on their space journey. For 13 years, they toured the mysteries of the four giant outer planets, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune at close range, collecting data and transmitting stunning images. But the greatest image recorded was on February 14, 1990, when Voyager 1 went to the edge of the solar system, and it showed you can see here a very beautiful image of a pale blue dot. You can see this is the image of the Earth, very tiny dot of the Earth. So when they saw from there, the Earth looks just like a tiny small dot. They couldn't imagine, they thought that it is significant. There is no meaning in life. There is no purpose in life. We are insignificant people. So that's why it started. Now the world is, there is no meaning. We are all insignificant compared to the whole universe. That's why they started projects like SETI, extraterrestrials. They wanted to search for extraterrestrial intelligence. And they thought there are so many galaxies, so many planets, and so many stars with planets around it. Might be somewhere some extraterrestrial is there. But this research proved that our Earth is special, as opposed to the thought that Carl Sagan said, because of the little pale blue dot, that we are insignificant. This search for SETI, you know, people tried a lot. This 1950, Enrico Fermi, a Nobel Prize winning physicist, he posed the question, where is everybody? Because he thought there are billions of stars, there should be so many extraterrestrials. But finally, he could not find anyone. So that is the greatest Fermi paradox. The cry, is there anybody out there, but actually not able to find? Because, and even Frank Drake, he brought in a lot of equations to tell that this many extraterrestrials should be there. Even Voyager 1 and 2 carried a lot of things, thinking that extraterrestrials will be there and they can communicate the story of humanity to them. But till now, they haven't found anybody. So then what is the speciality of our Earth? That's why you should see the movie Privileged Planet. You will get astonished. There is, our Earth is special compared to so many super Earths, so many exoplanets they have found. But our Earth has something great. You know, recently you might have seen in the newspapers, not recently, 1 or 2 years before, they have showed the picture of a black hole that was spotted at the center of a Messier 87 galaxy. That was a giant galaxy in the constellation Virgo. Until this time, we saw black holes only in movies like Interstellar. But now they are more real. Scientists exclaimed, we have seen what we thought was unseeable. the black hole, several billion times more massive than our sun, was unleashing a violent jet of energy into space. What if you're going in close to the black hole? You will be sucked into it. Even at the heart of our Milky Way, there is a supermassive black hole that feeds a spinning disk of gas. Why don't we see it? Because we can only see its event horizon. And now, luckily, our sun is located about 2/3 of the way outward from the center of the galaxy where this black hole is there, between two major arms in the inner rim of a minor arm called the Orion arm. Scientists are intrigued about this position. What happens if you move from our present position to the center? We will be sucked by the black hole. Our star density will be more. What happens if you move away? Elements will be less and life cannot exist. So it's fascinating that something great in our position, even our sun is a population one yellow dwarf star, it's never going to become a black hole. It has a stable next 5 billion years. Then comes the location of the Earth. Why this location of the Earth is so specific? Earth is one of the terrestrial planets with liquid water, unlike Jupiter, Uranus, Saturn. While Venus and Mercury are too hot, Mars is not hospitable because its atmosphere is just 1/100 as dense as the Earth. The reason is its gravitational pull. It's not sufficient to hold the atmosphere. The habitable planet is in the cold Goldilocks zone, not too hot, not too cold, not too far, not too near, not too small, not too big. It's just right. So even our Earth is surrounded by so many layers of, First you can see this mesosphere, then which protects us from meteors. Then you can have the greenhouse effect. So many things why we are able to have. I'm just showing you right now. I'm sharing the screen. See, this I was telling, we are in this place. And if you move towards the center, there's a black hole. If you move outside, elements are less. And now here, one more interesting thing. Why are we getting solar eclipse, total solar eclipse? The moon is far away from the sun 400 times and it's smaller than our Earth 400 times. So the sun is 400 times the size of the moon. The sun is also 400 times away from the moon than the moon is from the Earth. So what makes this coincidence? Can you think, is it a fluke? Can it come without an intelligent designer? There is an intelligent designer behind each and everything. There are so many parameters. Because of lack of time, I'm not going into it. When one other thing I wanted to tell is the finely tuned parameters of the universe. For example, the force of gravity, the mass of proton to neutron ratio, everything, even the expansion coefficient. If the Stephen Hawking said, if the expansion rate of expansion is 1/100 trillion times slower when it started, then the whole universe would have crumbled. What is it that breathes fire into the equation? He's telling. At the end, an atheist has to stand and blink how it is possible. Because even though it's a full set of equations that defines, something is there that breathes fire into those equations. It's startling everything right from the sunlight to the very laws of physics suggests that the universe was carefully designed such that it was expecting life to come into existence. That's why many times we always think that science and faith are opposite. But actually, science shows that the faith in God is not rational. It is rational because Bible says, only a fool says that there is no God. You know, somebody was telling a beautiful little story. For example, you are getting into a space shuttle and you got a room where in the space and you're docking your space shuttle there. And then you enter inside, you see a machine there that's called as universe generating machine. And you enter there, there are a lot of dials. And you see the dial, some around 100 dials are there. If you change the dial, for example, the force of gravity, one dial. The other one is cosmological constant, proton ratio, everything. Slightly you change, the universe is going to crumble or life cannot exist. Then you stand there and think some designer should be there who have fixed everything. Otherwise, it wouldn't have come on its own. That's why Bible beautifully says in Psalm 8, How majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and stars, what is man that you're mindful of him, the son of man that you're thinking of him. So next, the first we saw about the universe, second we saw about the earth, planet earth, and now I'm coming back to the final life on earth. How this life came? Did we evolve from apes? How did we come into picture? Richard Dawkins says that the universe we see has the properties we can expect if it has at the bottom that there no design, no purpose, no evil, no good, only pure indifference. He said that before Darwin came, there was a strong evidence for design. But when Darwin came along, we know that it is not, design is not real. It's just an illusion. It's all due to the unguided, undirected process called natural selection acting on random variation and random mutation. What is this natural selection? It is something I can explain with a Bible story similar to Jacob. You can see Jacob, he was keeping all the sheep and he was trying to breed the sheep. Now I wanted to tell about this breeding, selective breeding. For example, in the 14th century, Spanish sheep breeders, what they did is they breeded their Spanish sheep with English sheep. And finally, they got a breed called Merino sheep, which is a nightmare that humans have ever made. This is because these sheep cannot shed wool on its own, a vital survival trait for sheep. Because it is used to grow 40 pounds of wool every year. And unless a man removes the wool, it cannot shed it on its own. That is the worst thing. But you can increase the woolier sheep and get wool by making it more woolier, by making a female woolier sheep with a male woolier sheep to breed. But Darwin thought, what if you are having an intelligent person to do this breeding? Now, what if the environment itself does this breeding? What if nature itself does this breeding? Now, you have a very cold climate and this only woolier sheep can survive. So the less woolier sheep dies away and goes away from that place. And so finally, after some time, survival of the fittest, the more woolier sheep comes. So like this, he thought that this is natural selection. And he, when the DNA came along, they brought in random mutation. So using this, he decided that you will get new species. But this is just an adaptation. This is just a microevolution. For example, a color changing, or he went to Galapagos Island and he saw the beaks of the birds changing and the color of that changing. So this is because of the environment. But he used the same phenomena to bring in major life form changes. He thought that because of this phenomena, we came from apes and a mammal came from fish. And mammals, sometime back, it went back to the sea and again it became fish and it became a whale. So there are a lot of confusions and dinosaurs became a bird. See, dinosaurs and other reptiles are cold-blooded. And now birds are warm-blooded. How it is possible to change? There are so many confusion in it. And he brought in this tree model where the small microorganisms grow, and finally from the base, it starts as a tree. But I wanted to say there are five reasons to show that this is false. Let me show from my screen. So for example, let me show you now, this is a design or pattern. This is the eagle rock. You have this eagle and this is a cloud. So now this is a pattern, but here in the Mount Rushmore, the faces of the presidents are engraved. So this is a design. So there is a difference between a pattern and a design. Same manner in God's universe, you can see cleanly designed that without a design, the designer design cannot come. Mainly you can see this is a DNA. This DNA proved everything what Darwin said as false. you can see the central line and here ATGC. So now, for example, I have CAD-CAM. If you are working on CAD-CAM, you know that you need to program, and the programming thing will make equipments, will make a car, will make a Boeing. So now I need a programmer to program it. The same manner, like 0101. Here you can see ATGC. So now this programming tells that some particular cell will become a hand, will become a leg, how the baby will grow, how the baby's color will come, how the baby's height will come. Everything it will design based on the programming of this DNA. So this DNA is just a tiny dot. You have 3.1 billion bits data. You know, this transcends the human realm and goes into the miraculous. So that is why even Bill Gates said nobody can get a complexity like that. If DNA is the first one which shows you that it is impossible without an intelligent designer, the next one is the molecular machines. In our body, we have ATP synthase, so many molecular machines. This is a bacterial flagellum. You know, this bacterial flagellum has a propeller which rotates at the speed of 10,000 RPM per second. And it has liquid cooled, it has a stator, it has a rotor, and just a tiny little bit, you have so many complicated equipments. You just take one thing, everything will stop functioning. Darwinian evolution cannot explain this. It just fails. So that's why what I wanted to say is Darwin came along and he tried to tell that everything came by naturalistic process. But first, Cambrian evolution. Cambrian evolution is that 530 million years back, at one particular strata, they found so many life forms at the same time coming into picture. If evolution is true, that can never come. So many different forms of life can never come at the same time. And Darwin also was telling you can see a lot of transitional fossils. But as science advanced, they searched for transitional fossils, but nothing they could not find. And they tried to now tell Neanderthals, so many things they are bringing in. But you can just see when you go in depth and check it up, either it will be an ape or it will be like a man who had got some disease with a big head or something. So till now, they could not exactly point out where there are transitional fossils in the picture. And even the chromosomes, how the chromosomal transfusion happens from apes to human beings, they are bringing in theories. But even that theory, a lot of new scientists have proven it is wrong. In my book, third chapter, I've given a lot of latest evidence to show that how all these theories are false. So if the first one is DNA proved everything that without information, for example, if I'm speaking, I have a language. To speak, I need a mind. So because you have information, you need a mind behind it. DNA is an information. You need a mind behind it. And molecular machines, without even one part you take it out, the whole thing will collapse. That means Darwinian evolution is wrong. And again, Cambrian explosion and this transitional life forms. The final key is how the first life came into picture. The first life, that is the last one I explain and close my thing. The first life, how it came into picture, in 1953, Stanley Miller announced in his laboratory that he would make the life, first life. He made some amino acids, the chemical building blocks of proteins, and from some inorganic chemistry became organic chemistry, he proved. And everywhere papers were flashing that the secret of life was shown, that everything has been demonstrated, that scientists have succeeded in the first step in the origin of life. But now when DNA came into picture, they understood that some of the components, what this Miller-Urey produced, is toxic to DNA. And even they use only reducing atmosphere, the first Earth had even oxygen. And they also used a trap to remove it. Like this experiment where proved false, now nobody speaks about it except some of the textbook has it. So what I wanted to say is this first life, how organic chemistry came from inorganic chemistry, Nobody is able to tell. So now with all these things, why people are still believing that there is no God? Because my PIs finally came to the conclusion that sometimes the Bible says Satan has blinded your eyes. That is the first reason. So we need to pray that their eyes will be open to look at the truth. Jesus said, I am the truth, I'm the way, I'm the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And then the second thing, what I feel is many times we fail to be the salt and the light to the world. Bible says in 2 Corinthians 2:15, for we are the fragrance of Christ to God among those who are being saved, among those who are perishing. But are we remaining as a fragrance, or we are giving bad smell to the people around? And the third reason why people don't believe in God is suffering. When suffering strikes, they can't believe in an all-powerful and all-knowing, all-loving God. That's why we need to be so compassionate enough to show them how this God of the Bible makes sense. So let's close our eyes and I'll just finish it with a little prayer. Precious Heavenly Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for speaking to us through your word. And Lord Jesus, today, whomever have listened, Father, let them become your ambassadors to carry this message to the dying world that you exist and you are the most powerful, awesome, all-loving God. And you are with us every minute with the power of the Holy Spirit. Make us as fragrance of you, Lord Jesus, so that we can be light and salt to this dying world out there. Thank you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.